Hello and welcome to this module 9 on manufacturing systems technology. And this would be probably one of the concluding modules on how to do the curve fitting in complex topology, etc. So a quick recap of what we did in the last section or last module. So we talked about the various forms of representing equations as parametric and non-parametric forms. We further mentioned that these can be either implicit or explicit depending on the relationship being a direct one between two variables, or relationship being an indirect one because of maybe multiple equations, multiple variable kind of problems. So we also learnt about how with parameterization you can actually vary the curve locally given a global relationship between two or more parameters like x, y, z, so on and so forth, which describes a 2D or a 3D curve. So particularly we studied the case of a straight line where introducing an extra parameter t there would allow us to vary the the fit of the curve between the various local small domains, while the global domain of the straight line remains the governing basis for variation of such local domains. So we would like to just analyze a few more example problems today in this matter. One of them is this ellipse. So you can see that there is an ellipse in this particular equation where we want to develop the non-parametric form of the equation and also the parametric form. So if we look very closely at the ellipse, there are various parameters which are mentioned here. One is this major radius A of the particular ellipse and the minor radius B. Okay, so the major radius in this particular case is capital A and the minor radius is capital B. So also important is this point C, which is actually the geometric center of the particular ellipse, where there are location coordinates small a and small b representing the C. So as you may reckon from first level coordinate geometry, the equation for such an ellipse would be x minus small a square by square of the major radius plus y minus small b square by square of the minor radius equal to 1. So this becomes then the implicit non-parametric formulation of the equation describing an ellipse. So obviously implicit, because there is a clear cut relationship between x and y in terms of some knowns a b small or a b capital and 1. Okay, and non-parametric because again the governing relationship is directly between x and a, x and y, without involving any extra parameter. Let us now plot the parametric equation of the same ellipse and if we again look very closely here, if we are talking about an array of points, let's say x, y, somewhere on the periphery of the ellipse or somewhere on the let's say the trace of the ellipse, the x, y can be defined in terms of the already existing location coordinates of the point C or the centroid C, which is at a distance of let's say small a from the origin and small b particularly in the y axis from the origin. So we can define the x coordinate of the point V, okay, at this particular V, as equal to the A plus CW, which is this particular length. Okay, that's how you can define the x coordinate of V. Similarly, Y can be defined as the expression B, okay, where somewhere around here, plus the amount of distance which would move by translating W all the way to V, so plus VW. Okay, so that's how X and Y can be defined. And let us see if we can, in process of defining this C and W, involve an extra parameter alpha. For example, in this particular case where alpha is an angle and can vary between 0 and 360 degree to define the whole ellipse. So obviously it can be, because if we look at CW, so in triangle CPW, we can say that CW is nothing but the major radius, which is actually capital A in this particular case, as can be geometrically visible here. This is A, okay. So it can be geometrically visible here. So A times of cos of alpha, and therefore the simultaneous the x coordinate can be defined by small a plus capital A times of cos of alpha. Similarly, in a similar manner, if I look at the triangle, much shorter triangle, let us call this point W dash. Okay. So, we are looking now at a triangle in triangle C Q W dash. Okay. If I were to look at the total amount of displacement Q W dash, that would be equal to obviously V W. Okay. And Q W dash further in this particular triangle can be mentioned as the smaller or the minor radius of the ellipse B sine of alpha. Okay. So, therefore, y can be represented as b plus small b sine of alpha. So, these two then formulate the so called parametric equation of an ellipse, where the alpha now can be varied between 0 and 360 degrees to produce the whole trace of x and y, the variable point on the ellipse surface. So, in a way, that is how you can represent both the implicit parametric, non-parametric and the parametric form of equation for a particular ellipse shape. So, today, you know, after doing all these different regular geometrical problems, I would like to move on a little bit and give you an illustration of how to really represent a surface through synthetic curves. Now, what is the utility for synthetic curves? Let me just come to that explanation first. So, you know that in modern day engineering, there are a huge variety of surfaces which have complex topology. For example, there can be, you know, the propeller blades of an airplane, the fuselage which is of an extremely complex shape, the wings of an airplane, so on and so forth. Or for example, you know, in flow assistance, in aerodynamic flow assistance for compared to moving bodies like, let us say, automotives or even airplanes, a lot of complex topologies are involved, which is otherwise not very easy to plot using regular describable geometric parameters like lines, arcs, curves, circles, ellipse, parabola, hyperbola, so on and so forth. So, therefore, the question of representing them more accurately come into existence when we talk about synthetic curves to define such geometric parameters. So, we would like to now show how to represent using synthetic curves the complex topologies or shapes. So, before doing that, let us say that you know, a good, first of all, a good representation of engineering objects has to have at least the following properties. Okay. So, what are the properties? One of them is easy to control. You are having curves to control the topology. For example, let us say when you are talking about hermit cubic spline kind of a curve, you can see there are various segments of these curves which are sort of interconnected along these particular points. Okay. So, there are small curves which are representing the actual topology. Now, the question is how much would be the variability in this local domain, okay, starting for all these different points, so that there can be a good shape given to the overall fitment of these curve components to a particular topology. So, it should be easy to control the continuity of the curves. Okay. It should not be that between these two points there is some discontinuity which exists between the curves. Similarly, it should require lesser storage, particularly data storage when you are talking about representing of the curves. Obviously, they should have less computation time and absolutely no computational problems as far as the you know, individual components of these curves are concerned, and then of course easy to input by the user. So, these are the properties that should be there in these synthetic curves, so that they can match the complex topology cases that we are considering. So, there are at least three different kind of you know, formulations which are there, and essentially it boils down to fitting of local sections of the whole complex topology for governing the whole nature or array of such curves which are representing the complete surface or complete topology. So they are Hermit cubic spline, Bezier curves, and B spline curves. And briefly, the Hermit cubic spline fit is sort of a family of curves which is formed by a set of position vectors and their slopes. At least the end position vectors and the end slopes are important for varying the topology along this particular domain of the curve. The Bezier curves, where the curve is formed by a set of control points, no slopes are needed. So in a way it is handy. For example, in this case you can see there are different control points over which this complex surface topology has been developed by just variation of this control point. The idea here in the Bezier curve is that, practically speaking, the slopes at certain points are very difficult to measure. For example, how will you measure the slope at V dash 0 or, for example, V dash 1, okay, at this point? So Bezier has an advantage over Hermit in that, you know, it does not need the slopes, it only needs the position vector of the points itself. And finally, of obviously, the B spline curves, where variation of these points would also change the convexity concavity part of the curve. For example, if you compare with Bezier, the difference between B spline and Bezier is that if this point were to vary, maybe the curve will vary in terms of the bulge without really having a crossover from a convexity into a concavity. But in this particular case, you may have that additional advantage of varying it locally, even in its curvature, you know, apart from the other parameters. So we will just investigate some of these curve tracings as we go along. But for plotting a surface, one part of course is the engineering curve that is used to plot the surface. The other part is how we are able to connect such curves to each other in a continuous manner or in some kind of a relationship, so that there is a sort of a complete mapping, without any breaks or without any discontinuity of the surface which is in concern. So we want to now first investigate this concept of continuity for plotting such curves. Intuitively, continuity means the smoothness of the connection of two curves or surfaces at the connection of two curves or surfaces at the connection points or edges, okay. And normally, three types of continuities are existing. They are called C0, C1 and C2 continuity. C0 continuity, as can be seen here, implies simply connecting two curves, that is it. You know, the two tangents of the two curves that intersects should intersect to each other at the at one of the points, which would mean that the curves are in physical touch with each other, and physically they are continuous. So the gradients of these curves at the point of joining may be different, okay, but they are essentially intersecting. That is the basis of C0 continuity. The C1 continuity again has the gradients at the point of joining as the same. So you can see the tangent at the point of joining of this section of the curve is slope wise similar to the tangent at this section of the curve, okay. So that is how C1 continuity is defined. And then now C2 curvature continuity would mean typically that not only the tangent but the center of curvature would be uniquely similar. In case of first order continuity, the center of curvatures may be different. For example, in this cases you have two different center of curvatures for plotting these two curves with only a condition of the tangent or the slope being similar at the line at the point of intersection. But here in this case, in the second order, you can see that not only the tangents are similar but also the curvature is similar. That is how you do the C2 curvature continuity, okay. So there are essentially C0, C1 and C2, three different forms of continuity which can ensure that two such sections or two such synthetic portions of the curves can be connected to each other in some relationship or in some governing relationship which can actually map the whole surface continuously without any breaks, okay. So in a nutshell, the different types of the synthetic curves that we would like to just explore are the Hermit cubic spline, the Bezier curves, the B spline curves, the rational B spline and non-uniform rational B spline. We would give emphasis to the to the first two kinds with a description of the third kind, and in the interest of the time would sort of keep the rational B spline and non-uniform rational B spline for just, you know, reference, so that you know, if you are interested as a reader to go through, you can do that. So we in the next module would like to take up these two different Hermit cubic spline and Bezier curves in some details and try to do some geometric fit with these two curves. This brings us to the end of this module, and I would like to take up the various curve fittings, the actual curve fittings, starting next module. Thank you so much.